gentlemen, good evening and welcome. It's wonderful to see such a turnout tonight. It's not the greatest night to be away from the fire, is it? But we're really pleased that you're here, and I know that our hotshot speakers here are going to add a glow to the evening. Certainly they are. My name is Fiona Armstrong. I'm a broadcaster, worked in radio and television variously, and I'm also a Preston girl. My parents still live here. And I'm... Hey! So any excuse to come back here. And I'm a member of the UCLan board as well. And, you know, it's a wonderful thing when you work in television, you get instantly recognised as soon as you get outside. And I was here a couple of weeks ago for a meeting of a board committee. And my mother and I went shopping earlier, and we were in the Avenham shopping centre, and this lady was following us around, and I knew that she'd recognise me. And she suddenly came up and she said, "Excuse me," she said, "but I know who you are." And I sort of smiled, and my mother smiled, and she said, "Yes," she said, you're that Angela Rippon, aren't you?" And I said, "No, not." And she said, "Well, I know that when you're on television, you don't like to be recognised. But do you mind if I go home and tell my husband I've met Angela Rippon?" So anyway, I made somebody happy that day. Right. I was looking at our panel, whom I will introduce in a minute, our panel. And I was thinking, of all this panel here, I am the only one who's ever had a vote on Europe. I mean, you may not believe it. I look much younger than these guys. But they have never had a vote on Europe. And I have, and it was back in the 70s, and was one of really was my first vote as a teenager. I was 18, and I didn't know what to do. And I asked my father. I said, "What should I do?" And he said, "Go in, you know, stay in Europe." He said, "Great for trade. It's exactly what we want." You know, and more than 40 years later, 2 weeks ago, when I was staying with my parents, there's my old man at the kitchen table, and he's moaning on about Europe and saying, "Wasteful, bureaucratic. We have to come out." So, I mean, the EU really, it's been a source of division and argument and debate for decades. I looked up some facts and figures. 4 years after we joined, 47% of those polled said they wanted out again. In 1980, 71% wanted out. In 1991, that figure was down to 30%. And now, of course, the polls are suggesting that some 45% are for Brexit, which suggests that 55% want to stay in. Well, whether you trust the polls or not, tonight we're running a Twitter poll where everyone is welcome to vote in. It's displayed on our UCLan Twitter account and is going to be live for 24 hours. And you can also join in the debate by mentioning @UCLan in any tweets that you decide to make. Okay. We're going to start with a show of hands. This is the bit where you do a little bit of work. You will notice you've got some cards in front of you. One says stay, but actually it should say remain. Think that it means remain. And the other says leave. And that will give us an indication of how you, the audience, intends to vote in the referendum. Then we're going to hear a speaker from each side of the debate. And then we've heard the first speakers, we're going to take a question and answer session. And then we're going to hear second speakers on each side of the debate. Each speaker will talk for 15 minutes, and please don't interrupt them. I know you will want to stand up and throw bricks and shout and whatever, but be a good audience, otherwise we will have to deal with you. And then following the final two speeches, each side will have 5 minutes for a sort of final rebuttal of what the other side has said. And to close the debate, we're then going to ask you to show another vote, because that will show us whether large chunks or just a few of you have been influenced by what you've heard here tonight as to how you intend to vote in that very important June election. It is a huge decision. If we vote to leave, will the UK find itself a scratchy outsider with limited access to the single market and no influence and no friends, Billy no mates? Or if we vote to remain, will the EU stretch its tentacles further, wider and deeper into every nook and cranny of our lives? Those are both quotes from some of the magazines and internet blogs that you've been seeing, and haven't we been bombarded with them over the last few months? So, let us talk about how you plan to vote. Have you all got your cards? Shall we have a show of hands? Could you put your cards up? How you think you're going to vote? If you don't want to put a card up, that's fine. Right, now who's going to help me with this? So the red card is the leave and the blue is the stay remain card. I mean, to me, the stay remain is about twice as many, would you say, guys?
The question was pretty high.
Yeah. So, I mean, I think that the stay is bigger than the leave. I have to say that. But whether we can influence you, I don't know. Let me introduce our panel here. On my left-hand side, we have the Remain, and we have Professor Mike Thomas from UCLan. Mike Thomas is Vice-Chancellor here at UCLan. And we're also very lucky to have the Preston MP, Mark Hendrick. So that is the Remain side. And on my right side, we have the Leave, and we have Dr. Mark Baimbridge, who's come up from the Midlands. He's an economics expert at university. And we also have John Bickley. Now, the clever ones among you will notice that this is not Phil Wyman from UCLan, who was due to talk. He's much better looking, this guy. But seriously, John has stepped in at the very last minute because poor old Phil, unfortunately, who's also very good looking, was very ill last night. So we literally were chasing around this morning trying to find somebody, and we're very, very lucky to get John. John is speaking for UKIP, and he stepped in at the last minute, so we're grateful that you've turned up. Thank you very much indeed. Right. As I said, this is a huge decision, and it is time for our first speaker. And if I could introduce him, Professor Mike Thomas, as I said earlier, is UCLan's Vice-Chancellor, speaking for the Remain side. Mike was a student of healthcare. He's got a master's in law, and he's got a PhD in psychotherapy. And he's also alumnus of the Said Business School at Oxford and chair of several external regional boards. He's led three social enterprise companies, and he acts as a consultant to the third sector organisations. Mike, if you'd like to take the stage, please, or the microphone over there. Professor Mike Thomas.
Thank you, and welcome to the University of Central Lancashire. I'm here tonight to formally speak on behalf of the university sector, or the Universities UK, which is the body that represents the university vice-chancellors. About 100 vice-chancellors in the UK have signed up to say that we wish to debate for the Remain camp. So that's what I'll be doing tonight. If I say anything personal, I'll preface it with the words, in my personal opinion, so that nobody here can go and say to the other vice-chancellors, do you know what, he said this on your behalf. So forgive me about that if I say that. I just want to say two things before I start, really. The Remain cards seemed a bit higher than the out cards or the leave cards, which I think puts a lot of pressure on us, really. It's better if it had been more equal. So I hope when I finish and Mark Hendrick, our Member of Parliament, finishes, that we haven't put any of you off, but we'll see at the end. And it's good to welcome Mark and John for stepping in at the last moment, and we're hoping for a decent debate, really. Couple of other points. I am not in favour of a federal Europe, and I'm not in favour of a United States of Europe. I say that before I start, because some of the things I say may make some of you think, oh, well, he's leading us towards a federal or a United States, and I'm not. Neither do I worry about sovereignty. Personal background, I served 5 years as a submariner, so I think I know a little bit about treaties and a little bit about sovereignty from a sort of on-the-ground, working out there sort of outlook. So I'm very comfortable about UK sovereignty. What I want to talk about, really, is three things. Slight bit on economics, though I recognise that Mark is a professor of economics, so I'm very careful about what I say there, particularly before I hear him speak. I'm going to talk a little bit about politics, but I'm conscious we have the Member of Parliament here, so I'll be very careful. And I want to talk about global relations. So those are the three areas I want to cover, really. I think for a lot of people in the UK at the moment, they are genuinely undecided about where to go. I think the debate that we're having tonight and leading up to the referendum itself shouldn't be constrained by economic arguments. My argument is that there is more to life than money, and there's more to life than wealth. There are lots of other things that make a human being a human being. But I recognise the importance of economics. We note from a lot of the studies and people we talk to that if you're an owner-producer or a small company, then you're more likely to say, well, actually, I'm fed up with the Euro bureaucracy and I'm fed up with the red tape. And we know that the larger the companies get, the more they go, well, look, you know, we'd like to stay in because there's uncertainty and we're not sure. Probably the only thing we do know for a fact is that there will be some uncertainty about sterling, and there'll probably be some fluctuation about sterling, irrespective of which way the British public vote. But it is interesting that if you run a small company or a medium-sized company, there is a sense that bureaucracy is something that people resent. And for large companies, particularly investments, those who do capital, banking and financial, they would like to know what's going to happen for the next 3 years. We'll never know, but it would be really interesting to know how many English companies or UK company executives are currently hedging their sterling exchange rates and probably moving into dollars, etc. But we'll probably never know that. But I do think that the economic argument is a bit negative. What we're getting is statistics rather than facts. What we've had so far is, well, one side will say this, and that'll be rebutted by the other side, who will say this, and then the other side says, no, it's a bit like tennis, really. I don't know if you watch tennis, but in the Euro debate, it'll probably get very boring after a while. So we do need to be more positive. There are positive issues that we can discuss, both for staying and remaining and leaving. And we need to highlight, really, the good things about EU membership. And that's what I want to try and cover, really. From a university's perspective, if I move on quickly to economics, universities in the UK are civic organisations. We're not public bodies. We are commercial organisations. In effect, in sort of organisational terms, we were denationalised several years ago in the early 90s. And we rely on income, by and large, from students who get loans from the student loan companies. So universities fall or survive by the students they recruit, plus research income, and plus other types of business engagement income. If you look at UK universities just in Europe, these are some of the good things that we have with the benefits there. EU UK staff make 15% of our membership. In other words, we recruit staff from Europe. In fact, one of the deputy vice-chancellors of a large university in the northwest is French and brings that sort of outlook and that sort of perspective to the business economy and the business that university do. The EU students make up 5% of the student body in the UK. There are 2 million students in England. So 5% of those are EU students. In 2011 and 12, those groups of students spent 3.7 billion or bought in 3.7 billion pounds into the UK economy and created 34,000 jobs. My university, University of Central Lancashire, has a turnover of around 225 million pounds. The student body that we have here spend about 172 million in the local economy. So students bring money in, and we create, just in our procurement chain here, outside of the staff, about 4,300 jobs around the city. Now, that's global, but it's just to give an example of how important students are. There is a European-funded scheme called Erasmus, and that funds our students to go and study in Europe. In the last 4 years, 200,000 students have gone from the UK to study in Europe, and about 20,000 staff have gone there on that scheme. What's really interesting is that those students have a 40% better chance of getting employment because of their European experience than students who don't go there. We are part of a bloc, we're part of a European Union bloc, but the UK does exceedingly well in research. If you think of all the countries in members of the European Union, the UK alone gets 20% each year, roughly, of all the research funding allocated. So we get a bigger share of the cake, really, and we have a very loud voice in that area. And if you look at some of the European funding we get about £687 million a year from things like European Social Fund and European Regional Development Fund. And over 80% of our research paper are co-authored with European colleagues. And that gives European UK universities a global standing, makes us some of the best higher education institutes in the world, really. Now, you could argue, well, we give money to the EU anyway, and what you're getting back is a percentage of what we would give. But the question I would ask as a Vice-Chancellor is, that's a good point. We get what we put in and slightly less than we put in. But we haven't had an answer yet from a government that would say, but we will guarantee you that if you come out. For me, it's very important that 200,000 young people in the UK get a taste of Europe, because it helps them get jobs. And if you're employers, you'll want students that are maybe bilingual or understand the European market. And we just don't know if we would get the same research funding. I know I'm stuck for time, so I won't talk too long about that. But if I move to politics, my view of the politics of the European Union referendum is I think it's a symptom of the population's frustration and perhaps anger at the lack of strong voice we have in Europe. And this perception that we have a weak voice, and we forget some of the strong history that we've had in Europe, things around how we've supported staff with better contracts of employment, about how we've supported employees to get better conditions, about the Maastricht Treaty, which was led by John Major. I think it's a symptom of the fact that people are frustrated, that Britain appears not to have a stronger voice. But for me, that's not an argument to leave it. That's an argument to stay in there and remain in the EU and put in efficient, skillful diplomats, ambassadors and politicians who can form alliances. Healey, Labour Chancellor, said that for him, politics was the art of persuasion. And for me, I sign up to that. The art of a European membership is the art of persuasion. And the fact that we haven't been that good at persuading is not, for me, a logical reason to come out. I think we can stay in and just skill up the staff and the politicians and the diplomats to be better. I worry, I don't want to talk about UK politics, but I do worry about global perceptions. We're not having a queue of countries coming up going, if you come out, here's the free trade agreement you'd have with us, or here's the free trade. They're just not appearing at the moment. Now, the next thing I say, please do not think that I'm an advocate for the United States of Europe or a federal Europe. I'm merely giving it as an example of what I personally think is a perception from some global members. There are 22 states in the United States of America that are roughly the same size as England. Some are smaller. How would people in the world, China, India, Australia, Africa, South America, feel if the state of South Carolina or New Hampshire said, we're going to leave the United States? Now, I don't want to talk about sovereignty. I know it's a sovereign country. I'm talking about perception. The people go, this, and they go, and don't worry about talking to the rest of the United States. Just keep talking to us. And I do worry that there's a lack of international voices coming forward to say, we don't have that perception. I think politically, it's a very, very dangerous game if people who are interested in politics vote to leave the European Union. Because remember, the vote is to just get a taste of the British public's opinion. If we vote to leave the European Union, the government will then still have to instigate Article 50, which is the process that will then say we are leaving. And that should take about 2 years, they think. I worry that some people will think, well, if we vote to come out of the EU and we don't instigate Article 50, we can go back and go, we'll only instigate Article 50 if you don't give us a better deal. And I really think that's a very dangerous game, because I think the rest of Europe will go, well, go. You can put Article 50 in. And very quickly, global relations. I think there is a perception of the UK. People keep saying we are the fifth biggest economy in the world. Well, we've also had a global crisis, 2008 to 2010. We've had 6 years of austerity now. We've had to bail out much of the banking sector. Here in the Northwest, we've had to really struggle to get inward investments. And some companies have really struggled to get leverage, financial leverage. And I think that we are part of Europe in a more humanistic, relational sense. I wouldn't like colleagues in Germany or France or Holland, Netherlands, to say, well, we're all neighbours in the same street, but for some reason you don't want to talk to us in the way we all talk to each other. You want to go to the other street over there and talk to them. But the other area, we don't know where the other there is, of course. It's just over there. But in a relational sense, I do think it's going to be very hard for our European colleagues to go, do you like us? If you like us, why are you leaving? And if you're leaving, what does that mean in the sense of you like us? And I think that's important for trade. I think it's important for student movement. I think it's important for joint research and publishing papers. I also think that globally, the world is getting smaller. Technology, flights, computers. But the blocks are getting bigger. The United States has a block. South America is forming a block. China has a trading block. Europe is a trading bloc. It has a voice in the world that I think represents the population of Europe. And I worry that our neighbours and our global colleagues will say, well, the world's getting smaller and blocks are getting bigger and you're deciding to go. And the last thing I want to say, really, because I do wake up in the night thinking about this and I do worry. Nobody seems to have wondered what would happen if in the referendum the majority of the English population say we want to leave, but the majority of the Scottish, the Welsh or the Northern Irish say, well, we wish to stay. And would that trigger then calls for a referendum? And we may be in this very strange world where it may just be England and the United Kingdom could break up. And that concerns me. But really, to sum up, students who spend study time in Europe are more likely to gain leadership positions in our society, whether that's in economics, business, civic duty or politics. And those students from Europe who come to the UK will gain a lifelong relationship with us as their career progresses. And who knows where that positivity will lead us. And what the rest of the world really thinks matters to the university sector. The university sector in the UK is a leader in education and a leader in research and a leader in innovation, both globally and in the European Union. And I think staying in the European Union would actually facilitate more global links. Thank you.
Mike, thank you very much there. Well, Mike Thomas speaking for the universities, explaining how the EU has had a great influence and a good influence on British higher education in terms of research, student numbers and staff. Mike's called for a more positive tone in this referendum because it is a bit scaremongering, isn't it, everything that's being said. He's talked about looking beyond British shores, and he's also talked about staying and fighting our corner in Europe. And that sentence that stuck with me, the world is getting smaller, but the blocks are getting bigger. Right, thank you, Mike. Our first speaker for the Leave side, let's see what he's going to say, Dr. Mark Baimbridge. Mark Baimbridge is Senior Lecturer in Economics at the University of Bradford. His main area of research is the political economy of the EU and the UK-EU relations. He's published more than 40 articles and he's written 12 books on the subject. And during the late 1980s and 90s, he worked with various think tanks to help kickstart the debate over EU membership. Mark, if you'd like to take the microphone, please.
Okay, I'm afraid, I say, apologies, Phil isn't here, so I've had to combine some of the things Phil was going to talk about in the economics with things that I was going to talk about. And as a university lecturer, we kind of wed to PowerPoint. So you can decide to sort of look at me, which I wouldn't recommend, or look at the screen, which I would recommend. And I'm going to be moving around a lot, because again, we don't kind of stand still. It's too easy for the students to hit us. So I'm going to talk about the case against membership, mainly about the economics of it. There are a couple of kind of key reasons why we ought to be thinking about this in terms of why we, as a country, we need to think about whether coming out of the EU overall. Manage your own economy is a kind of key one. Mike alluded to this, the issue about Britain as the fifth world economy. He's obviously listened to what I was saying in the green room, taking notes. But this perception of globalization can be exaggerated, and as a major economy in the world, we perhaps do ourselves down and don't think that we have the capability of moving ourselves forwards. What does the EU represent? It represents a relatively small part of the world, actually. It represents part of the world of about 7% of the population and about a quarter of world GDP, in other words, of wealth in the world. So the vast majority of what's out there that we can trade with, we can have economic relationship with, is outside the EU. Those shares are going to be declining as other parts of the world grow. If you sort of looked at people and said 20 years ago, China is going to be a major economy, they would have scratched their head and said, you're mad. And things obviously changed there. So the great opportunity is outside. There's also an issue in terms of the direction of the European Union. There's this balance between business and the social part of the European Union. And the argument perhaps is that it's moved away from the social side much more into the business side. And that can concern a lot of people who want to have a strong social dimension to it. Okay, some numbers. What I've tried to do with the numbers is take them from, and sure, Mark will be very proud of this, take them from the House of Commons Library Research paper as a sort of independent, neutral source of information. Lots of numbers get sprayed around on the TV by various people, as you know, and in the media and newspapers. So let's have a think. First of all, key issues, trade, I think. We have a trade deficit with the EU. In other words, they sell more things to us than what we buy from them. But we have a large trade surplus with the rest of the world. So the rest of the world, they want to buy what we make. Europeans don't, put it simply. What does that look like? Little graph there. So in terms of our trade balance, the overall bit is the vertical columns. But the key thing is the move between the EU and non-EU. So non-EU is pushing up into that surplus position. EU strongly in deficit. And this is one of the arguments about if we leave. If we leave, are they going to stop trading with us? And the answer is no. They need us to sell their products. If we turned away from them completely, there would be many industries, many countries would be driven to the wall in Europe. They call us Treasure Island for good reason. FDI, will we keep getting investment in our country if we go? Foreign direct investment, people investing in our economy. Most of the investment in our economy is in the service sector, which is obviously, as you kind of know, a large part of our economy. That mostly serves the UK. It's very hard to export a lot of services. Some bits are financial, you obviously can, but most of the other services that we take for granted, you can't. So that's going to carry on, and if we're a successful economy, it's going to stay coming in, because it's money which people are investing from outside into the British economy. So as long as we stay strong, we buy their products, their goods and services, that kind of thing, it's going to happen. What does it mean in terms of opinion? Over there, there's a sort of graph in terms of opinion, in terms of what happens if we leave. Will I invest more? Will I invest less? This is of businesses. It's the EY survey, a kind of major survey, which is done of business investment. Overall, if we leave, number of companies surveyed going to reduce or put on hold their investment, about 31%. Number of companies are going to actually increase or have no impact on their investment decisions, the vast majority, about 63%. So for most companies, this issue investment doesn't really come into the exit debate. The budget. How much do we give to the European Union? This year, 2016, the government estimate from the ONS is £11 billion. £30 million a day, or roughly by the time we finish this debate, we'll have paid the EU about £2 million. Okay? By the time we finish. What does that look like over time? There's the picture of it over time. It's scheduled to go up. We got a bit of a rebate, obviously, in the 1980s with Margaret Thatcher. But after that, it's gone up. As more countries have entered the EU, particularly poorer countries, from Eastern Europe, example, then that money has gone up gradually in terms of what we put in. The budget as a whole for the EU hasn't really grown very much, but how much we put in certainly is. And that's a net cost. So we're paying in that much this year, and it's likely to rise and keep rising as well. With enlargement, which again is consisting of countries mainly from the Western Balkans, Turkey, etc. Again, they're poorer countries, so that contribution is likely to go up. What we get back will keep on diminishing unless there's some radical change in terms of how the EU budget is designed. A few other little bits and pieces in terms of costs. Agriculture, common agricultural policy, is estimated to raise food prices by about 17%. If we could buy our food on the world market, our food would be cheaper. There's a similar thing with a common fisheries policy as well. Occasional economic forays into closer union, such as ERM, you may remember from the early 90s, joining the exchange rate mechanism, didn't go too well, ended a bit of a disaster, lost about 4% of GDP. So that's sort of having a mini recession, essentially, for a year. Not great. Our friend the euro. Thankfully, we're not in the euro, obviously, although there's a lot of people who suggest we still should be and moving into it. But the problem with the eurozone is it slows down the growth in the European economy. And yes, they are a key part of our trading. They account for around about 50% of the trade we do. But if they're forced to grow slowly because of things like the eurozone, that doesn't help them, but it doesn't help us either. We're tied into a group of economies who are moving much slower than what we'd really like them to be moving. So it hurts them, it hurts us. Just to mention now, briefly, this is kind of the things Phil was going to talk about, in terms of the negotiation. So David Cameron went away, negotiated, and came back with a set of recommendations, set of deal that he had in terms of various areas. One of the first areas he talked about was this issue of sovereignty, which I know John's going to talk about in more detail, but I'll just kind of run over these key things. Said that we can never be part of ever closer union, and we had this kind of new red card thing for national parliaments. If a majority of national parliaments don't like a piece of EU legislation, it will be rethought. What does that really mean in the real world? Well, the red card mechanism means you've got to build alliances within a very short period of time. The effectiveness of that, the likelihood of actually being used, is really quite minimal. They have a yellow card system at the moment, and that really hasn't been used much at all. They dropped key demands in certain key areas, which you may not agree with them as being desirable, but they had to drop those fairly quickly. So essentially, all we got out of it is we won't be forced into closer union, something that we probably didn't want to be in the first place. So we got out of being in something we never intended to be. So, migration, welfare benefits. Again, John's going to talk about this, I think, in a bit more detail. But what we got was this issue of still having to pay child benefit to reflect overseas costs in home countries. That actually means, as you probably realise, that we actually may be paying more because several European countries are richer than us. And so those costs may actually go up. So perhaps not what they first thought they were going to get in terms of the deal. Limit benefits for people coming from the EU working here for exceptional levels. But what does that really mean? Well, first of all, they didn't get really what they wanted, as I say, on child benefits. This emergency break is only a temporary thing, and you've got to try and define this issue of exceptional levels, which is always going to be a sort of murky situation to define. The other thing they negotiated was economic governance, which is really about the City of London, obviously a major part of the economy, but particularly in services. Prevent Eurozone regulations being imposed on it. That's what they got. And protection of the pound and getting any money back that we put in to bail out Eurozone nations overall. They didn't really get what they wanted, as it shows you on the right, in terms of the City of London. They wanted a lot more protection, but other European economies, particularly the French, weren't keen that we got sort of special treatment on that, so that didn't really work out. In terms of putting money into the euro bailouts and getting it back, it's very unlikely we'd be putting money in anyway. They have their own bailout mechanism within the Eurozone members. We're not part of that, therefore it's very unlikely we'd be putting money in, even in the first case. So it's kind of a guarantee you get money back, but you haven't actually bothered to put it in the first place. So there's not much happening there. Final one on these. What they negotiated was this issue of competitiveness, which is about strengthening competition, strengthening the single market, and to take concrete steps towards better regulation, which actually means less regulation in political speak. So better means less in this kind of world. To cut red tape, it was the idea. This they were a little bit more successful on, but similar promises have been made in the past, that countries would obey the rules of the single internal market, that they wouldn't secretly behind the scenes subsidize industries, prop up industries. And so we've heard this before, and nothing's really changed. So in terms of these areas, my suggestion is they don't really address the fundamental things, which is things like large trade deficit, the budgetary problem, issues around fish and agriculture and that kind of key areas, and also to do with investment. Most of what they negotiated is, frankly, smoke and mirrors. It's very simplistic ideas which will not really make a great difference to how we are with the rest of the EU. Our relationship with the rest of the EU is not going to make a lot of difference. Benefits and costs of exiting. There have been various studies on the costs and benefits. So this looks at the net benefits. So the higher up you are, the more benefit of leaving, the lower down, the more benefit of staying in. All the little dots are various studies which have been done over the years, going back to the mid-90s, going right up to date, for example, with the Treasury's long document, which I'm sure you've all got a copy of and read, all those lovely equations. Sadly, I have, but that's part of my job. Where they all fit in, about two-thirds of them fit in that sort of rectangle. Two-thirds of the studies fit in that area. What is that area? Well, it's about 2% a net benefit, about 2% in net cost. So in terms of the economics, even though obviously my our first speaker was thinking there's more to life than economics, which is fair enough, and I agree entirely on that, but in terms of the economics, the answer is it's pretty marginal. Either way. So either way you look at it, most of the studies fall into that small area. So it's fairly marginal that you can think about. So what could we do in terms of remain or leave? If we're looking at remain, then this is what the proposition is. Rely upon the newly negotiated terms. So the four or five ideas I went through, which I suggested actually don't really add up to very much. They're essentially smoke and mirrors time. Rely upon previous agreed opt-outs, for example, not to join the euro, which we've got as a kind of firm opt-out, and refusal to participate further, which quite likely, given British sentiment, even if you want to stay in the EU, you're quite likely on the angle of probably not going any further than where we are. Which again, Mike was sort of saying in terms of a European superstate and the United States of Europe. Problems with that? Well, our influence within Europe, which again I think John will talk about, is much diminished, and we can come back to that at the sort of rebuttal stage. Things like qualified majority voting, how Europe votes within ministers, within making decisions, weakens our ability to influence things. it doesn't address any of those big issues around trade, single market, budget, et cetera, et cetera. So that's my issue, my problem with the Remain position. So what could you do if you left? Yes, there's lots of negotiation to do. Article 50, Treaty of European Union, and there's supposed to be a two-year time period, but I think that would probably have to be extended logically, to be honest. But what could you do? Well, there's lots of things you could do if you left, but I'm just going to kind of present sort of two ideas, because I'm running out of time. You could rejoin European Free Trade Area. European Free Trade Area is something we kicked off back in the 1960s. And that would put us as part of what's called the European Economic Area. I'm going to show you a picture at the end to show what all that means. What does it mean? It means we have access to the EU plus a few other countries. So we'd have access to about 30 countries of about 510 million people of a wealth of about £13 trillion in terms of their wealth. So we could be very closely involved with the EU. There would be some cost to that. We have to pay a bit into the budget, but not as much as what we're paying now. We could step away even further. We could have some free trade agreements and decide what we want to do. Tariffs across the world have dropped significantly. For industrialized economies, less than 5%, so they're really very minimal these days. We could look at a bilateral trade agreement with the EU. So we go back to some kind of customs union type process with the EU. We could think about alternative trade alliances. People like the Commonwealth and maybe North America. Not becoming 51st state, but having a closer economic relationship with a key trading partner. And so finally, a map, but an economic map, not a normal map. This is what Europe looks like economically. You've got the European Union. Within that, you've got things such as the euro area, and within that, you've got countries who are involved in the euro, who are going to be involved in the euro, and countries like the UK who are not. The UK on that map, use me a little shiny light, is up there. The idea of taking a step backwards out of Europe and thinking about a different relationship would either put us in the European Free Trade Association or this European Economic Area. So in other words, you're moving from there over to here. I would suggest that is not such a big step that many people might think it would be. Thank you.
Mark, thank you very, very much indeed. Economics, of course, key to this referendum. And as Mark has pointed out, Britain is the fifth largest economy. We can trade with the rest of the world. We can trade with Europe if we come out. Pointed out that we put in billions and it's likely to keep rising. Things like food would be cheaper if we were outside Europe. We could join the European Free Trade Area, access to 30 countries. We could deal with the Commonwealth and America, although I still have in my mind Obama's back of the queue thing from last weekend dealing with America. Mark, thank you very, very much indeed. We're going to take some questions from the floor now, and we are going to ask Amy and Jenny with the microphones. If anyone has a question, can you pop your hand up? Sam, there's a lady. Is that lady in the middle there? Yes.
This is a question for the Leave people. One of the big things for the Northwest is our defence industry. You're talking in generalisations, you're talking about the macro economy. How will BAE Systems negotiate for these very, very complicated and expensive defence contracts? Once we're out of the EU, once the Germans at EADS and the French have said good riddance, we've still got the existing consortia, but they are very, very complex, the negotiations, and take a long time. What is going to happen to our Northwest defence industry?
John, would you like to take that?
I haven't got a microphone on.
Right, we will get you a mic. Who's got a mic here? We can get to John. Have we just got the one mic? Okay. Right. I think we'll need to find another one. Yeah.
Hi, how's that? Okay. Can you hear me okay?
Yeah.
Actually, I don't think anything of any material significance is going to happen. If you look at who our customers are, your customers are, do you work at BAE Systems?
No, I was a researcher here.
Okay. Well, I mean, you look at one of the biggest contracts BAE has had over the last 20, 30 years has been with the Middle East, Saudi Arabia. They're not in the EU.
Where the power's come from?
The chief executive of Airbus, a Frenchman, has made it quite clear that if we decide to leave, nothing changes over here in the UK. They'll still be investing, in fact, they're currently investing hundreds of millions of pounds in Broughton, where they make the wings for the A380 and the other Airbuses. The bottom line is we live in a globalised economy that works on the basis of skills, trade and business, and not necessarily political boundaries. And I think the Remain camp, really all they have to do is try and scare us all into thinking that we're incapable of actually running our own country and trading with the world. I mean, remember, Britain was the greatest trading nation on the planet not that long ago. So I have no fear that where we have the skills and the business acumen, we'll have no problem trading with people all around the world. We're a massive market, the fifth largest economy in the world, and therefore we should not be afraid.
Mark, have you got a quick view on that?
No, I can quickly run it. No, I mean, I would just to echo that, Fiona, I would sort of echo those comments in terms of, I think it's very interesting what it means at a local level. I was doing a similar talk earlier in the week, and people, this was back in Bradford, and people saying to me, what does it mean for Bradford? It is important to get it down to a local level issue, but as we say here, the real issue is who you trade with, who you develop contracts with, deals with, etc. And as John was saying, those transcend really political boundaries. If there is money to be made there, then money will talk at the end of the day.
Right, hand in the middle here. It's been up a long time.
Hi, my question's for Mike Thompson. I just was thinking about the point you made about, you know, our relationship with the countries in Europe. You know, how we are more than just economies, we're also people. And it just got me thinking about in the Scottish referendum, when they wanted independence from the United Kingdom, you know, a lot of all the major leaders within the UK politics went up to Scotland to say, you know, we want you to stay, be a part of our nation. And I just want to get your opinion on why we don't really get the same sort of sense from lots of European leaders. It doesn't feel like they're coming over and saying, you know, we want you to be a part of our European Union. It just seems like, okay, well, if you want to go, whatever.
Interesting question. Mike Thomas.
I think on one level, I think political leaders in Europe are very polite to us and very conscious in protocol terms that they don't want to be seen to be interfering in what they consider to be a UK business. But there is a truism in what you say, because we're just not getting world leaders or world business leaders coming forward to say, if you leave, this is the deal that you'll get. We're not future-proofing it. And I worry a lot about the Scottish situation. I do think that, certainly in the last poll, a lot of Scots wanted to stay in the European Union. And there's this irony for me that Britain, the United Kingdom, may say, well, let's leave the EU, but actually it'll just be England, and Scotland want to be independent, but they want to be part of the EU. So there's lots of minor politics. If I just say quickly, I know Fiona will shout at me, BAE is really, really important for the economy locally. It's invested millions in the Eurofighter. The Americans, of course, have invested millions in the replacement for the F-16s. The point about exporting the fighters to the Middle East isn't about the fact that we are outside of Europe. All the parts and all the partnerships and all the investments are with European partners, hence the term Eurofighters. There's one, you can't speculate about the future, but I cannot imagine the United States going, well, okay, you're out of the Eurofighter, you're not coming to the replacement of the F-16, so you'll have to come up with something else. It takes 40 years to develop a high-tech fighter. That's how long BAE's investment planning are. And there is, I think you could speculate that there could be some disturbance in that for BAE, which is a big employer locally.
Mark Hendrick, back to you. You worked in Europe. You're an MEP at one stage. So what about this question? Why aren't the European leaders coming over and actually lobbying and saying stay?
Well, Mike's partly answered the question in that they don't want to be seen to be interfering in the internal politics of another member state. And for that matter, the fact that President Obama made those comments has gone down well with some people on the Remain side, but actually people who may be in the middle are saying, well, what's it got to do with him? This is our business, not his. So this cuts both ways about foreign leaders getting involved in our internal politics. On the question of referendums, I'll touch on Scotland and that when I speak shortly, but this idea that leaving is a cost-free option is an absolute fantasy. We pay into the European Union to get the benefits, and obviously we pay in, that's a cost. The idea that we can get the same benefits without paying in is just ridiculous. It's not going to happen. Countries will look at us, and some countries will be furious, particularly those in Central and Eastern Europe, who we encouraged to join the European Union in order to pull them away from what was seen as the influence of Russia and the Warsaw Pact, which many of them were members of. And they're not going to be very pleased about Britain saying, well, we're going it alone now, and we can do as well, if not better, by being out, when we've encouraged many others to actually join. So this idea that it's a free ride to get out is, and on the point of BAE systems, many of the parts are sourced in other parts of Europe. If we're no longer members of the single market, then we're not going to get the parts on the same terms, because there may be tariffs, there may be barriers such as quotas, there can be all sorts of mechanisms that some of these countries that are furious about us leaving will actually want to impose. And it won't be just down to the French or the Germans. There are 27 other countries involved in this. So it is a major decision that is facing us, and it's not a cost-free option.
Not a cost-free option, just very briefly?
Again, you know, more scaremongering. If I was an Italian manufacturer of key components for the Eurofighter, guess what? I want to keep dealing with BAE systems in the UK. I don't really care about the European Union. I don't care about the British Parliament. I'm a businessman. I'm employing 50 people, let's say, in Milan. I want to keep trading with BAE systems. And the Americans who are building their new generation of fighters, they'll be very keen to want to trade with British companies that have got the technology and skill base to produce the parts they need. The world is a globalised economy. This idea that it's all controlled by political boundaries is really in the past.
It's economic boundaries.
John Wright, thank you very much indeed. Gentleman up there on the end, and then we'll come to this gentleman down here. Yeah.
I'd just like to talk about the UK, when it's been kind of compared to America, and we spoke about how if we had a debate where England would say to leave and Scotland would say to stay, that it would be equivalent to like California saying to leave. That's not a real comparison. A real comparison would be saying, what if there was, instead of a European Union, an American Union? We couldn't really envisage that America wanted to be part of a trade agreement that has a central government in, say, Mexico that controls all of their laws and has free borders. I think it's crazy to think that...
Well, but Mike, you were the one that raised that. That's not a good comparison.
No, I was very cautious when I did the preamble that I wasn't comparing the United States as a sovereign United States. What I was doing was trying to provide a picture of what members of the global community who don't quite understand the debate would see about this. And my view is they would see a smallish country, a part of a larger bloc, unilaterally deciding to leave that bloc. It was merely an analogy. You're right, you know, you can't compare. But I didn't mean it in a sovereign sense. I meant, what do those people in the world who don't know the intricacies of the debate view our decision if we decide to leave?
A gentleman here, a second along.
I just want to talk about this figure that's been going around for quite a long time. It's £335 million going out of this country into the European Union. And obviously, in a case of a Brexit, we're no longer going to be paying £335 million a week into the EU. A lot of people have been saying recently as this figure is going to be reinvested into our beloved National Health Service. Now, I'm going to be working in the NHS in a couple of years, so I'm really worried about this, because the people who have been saying this are actually the people who are totally against this junior doctors action. They're totally against the British, the BMA. They're totally against the NHS completely. So do you not think that that is in fact smoke and mirrors? Because they don't want a public service affecting the public people of the UK. They want the NHS to be privatised. If we leave the European Union, that £335 million a week, will not go into the NHS. It will go back into the city, into the bankers' pockets, where all of their cronies are.
John, very briefly, could it end up in the NHS or is it just going to go somewhere else?
Remember, it's taxpayers' money.
Yeah.
It's not money that belongs to the City of London. And I think you brought up a very good point here about the NHS, because the three main parties, Tory, Labour and Liberal Party, want to remain in the EU. Now, some of you will have heard about TTIP. This is a discussion that's going on between America and Europe about some form of a trade deal. One of the big issues in that is that the Americans want their corporations to have access to Europe and the public sector. The Americans want to be able to run the National Health Service. The Americans want to take over big institutions, public institutions in Europe. That's the fact. That's what the European Union is up to. I'm going to talk about this. Brussels.
Well, if you're going to talk about it,
we'll
leave that for the moment. No, very briefly, Mark, do you want to come back on that? Very briefly, yeah?
Yeah, I do. I mean, I remember there were many people who were anti-Europe used to say that if we stay in the European Union, they're going to privatise the NHS. They'll privatise the NHS if we come out of the European Union. That's the fact. Now, the same scaremongering tactics that were used when we were considering leaving the European Union in the past about the NHS are now being used to say that the Americans want to take over our NHS. This isn't true. By the time those negotiations are finished, they've got to be agreed by all 28 member states of the European Union. Now, not even the Conservatives, I think, want the Americans to take over our health service. They'd be much happier for British companies to take it over.
Thank you very much. I want to get a couple more questions. We haven't got much time for questions. There was a gentleman up there just in front with a question mark, and then we'll come to you at the back. And if you make it short, we can get a few more in, yeah?
Just an open question to any of you. I just wondered, do you think that certain personalities or politicians or actors have actually sort of hijacked the whole debate, like they've sort of turned it into a more of a way to sort of further their own careers, and that they might be turning certain voters off? Say, Boris Johnson and some of his recent escapades, do you think that's having an effect on him?
Mike, do you want to take that? Have they hijacked the debate?
I saw an interview with Greg Dyke a couple of weeks ago, and it was really interesting. He was talking about FIFA and the FA. But the journalist suddenly said to him, so are you going to stay in Europe? And he said, well, I probably will vote Remain, purely because I don't like the characters that are asking us to leave. So
what about a gentleman over here, with the red jersey on here?
I'm a little bit more concerned about local things. I have a property abroad and I travel extensively throughout Europe. If we come out of Europe, will we still have the same rights to travel freely across all the other borders that we do, all over Europe?
Yeah. I think it depends on what kind of agreement we strike, obviously, and that's the whole point at the end of the day. It is a big issue in terms of, as you say, tourism, travelling, that kind of angle. If we look at something which is very close to where we are now, as I was suggesting, that we sort of stay in the single internal market, but there are certain areas we don't sort of participate in, then nothing will particularly change. We will be in something like what's called the European Economic Area. So that's why people from other countries, such as Switzerland and Iceland, can come and travel around in Europe without any problems. If we went a little bit further, then in terms of striking some kind of trade deal, very much from outside of the EU, then I'm sure that would be part of the issue. I've done sort of radio talk-ins where I've had people ringing in sort of from Spain who are expats living out there saying, what's going to happen to me, et cetera, et cetera.
will they get thrown out? The answer is no, because if they were thrown out, then we could obviously reciprocate. London is the fourth largest French city these days. But also, if that kind of thing was done, the economic damage to those countries, if people had to sell up their houses in the Algarve or Costa del Sol or whatever it happens to be, if people did the same kind of thing in the UK, the economic damage, et cetera, would be too great. So the sensible thing, clearly, would be that would be part of negotiations, and it's very likely that nothing essentially would really change in that direction at the end of the day. That would be the logical and realistic outcome.
And then Mark, very briefly, will he still be able to travel in Europe?
Well, he won't be able to live in Europe in the same way that he can now. He won't be able to work in Europe in the same way that he could now. He may, if there's an agreement at some later date, be able to, like when you travel to many other countries, you'll be all right for a couple of weeks and then you'll need a visa. But all of the freedoms that we enjoy now, and by the way, there's a million Brits living abroad in Europe, many of them are working, and contributing not only to taxes in that country, but sending money back to this country. So this is a two-way street. It's not an easy option. It's not a cost-free option. You don't get the benefits of everything that you have when we're in the European Union if you come out. It's as simple as that.
Right, last question. There's a lady here. We'll take a question from a lady. Yeah, just on the end there. Sorry, guys. We're just running out of time.
Just like, you know, your point about the Americans will scaremongering, like the opposite side of Dawn. But also, my main question is, look around this room, there is hardly any students or younger generations here, and what is worrying me is that we are voting on something that half the future generation has not got any kind of say on or doesn't seem interested, because look around us. There is... Anyone under the age of 30 here?
That's quite a number. I'm sorry, we haven't got any time for any more questions.
Should have dyed our hair before we came in.
Can I just say one thing?
Yes, go on. Right, just a minute, ladies and gentlemen, just here, this one thing from Mike Thomas here. Ladies and gentlemen.
It's just to explain in one sentence, you know, that really, is it the heart or mind? And I think it will depend on people's emotions. But I listened to what you said. It was a really good question, by the way. But I was with some businessmen in Manchester yesterday, and one of them had a poll from expats in Spain. And one of the responses of the polls from expats in Spain was that it was disgusting that the European Union was interfering in UK affairs.
Yeah. Very good indeed. Right. On to our second Remain speaker, is a well-kent face in this part of the world. Mark Hendrick is Labour and Cooperative MP for Preston. He started his political career as a Salford councillor, then he became a member of the European Parliament, representing Central Lancashire. Mark's on the Foreign Affairs Committee, and he's on the HS2 Committee. Economics, Foreign Affairs, and Europe and International Development are his interests. Mark, if I can ask you to take the microphone, please. Thank you.
Thank you, Fiona. Ladies and gentlemen, the forthcoming referendum on the UK's membership of the European Union will say a great deal about how we feel and how British people see themselves. Are we a nation at peace with ourselves, comfortable in the belief that by working closely with others, that we can govern our peoples to the benefit of everyone? Internationalist in outlook and confident of our place in the world? Or are we fearful of the outside world, where it is the European Union that is doing Europe to us rather than us being a part of Europe? Or the threat of immigration, where the concept of free movement of European citizens has been conflated with the free movement of refugees, economic migrants and legal or illegal migrants from outside of the European Union? The reason that this referendum is taking place is because a desperate Prime Minister was held hostage by his own backbenchers by concern about the growing populism from and the popularity of, at the time, the UK Independence Party. This was foisted on us not by so-called Eurosceptics, because sceptics have a healthy scepticism and are quite objective. That's a misnomer. Well, I believe by vitriolic opponents of the European institutions who for the most part put forward so-called reforms which they knew would be unacceptable to the other 27 member countries in order to make the case for Britain leaving the European Union. And now that the Prime Minister has agreed a reform programme with our European neighbours, they see their job as to rubbish that programme, even though it went beyond what many of us had expected him to achieve. And I await with interest the response from our UKIP representative here tonight on that issue. Now, Britain's future, in or out, will this referendum settle the issue? I doubt it. The recent referendum in Scotland was closely fought, and now there are calls for another referendum in Scotland. If what I call the English nationalist tendency in the Conservative Party wins the argument and the UK opts to leave the EU, or if the Scottish nationalists win overwhelmingly in the Scottish parliamentary elections next month. This is why some of us refer to the referendum as a never-endum, because one side never accepts the outcome. And this is why I believe that the job of elected politicians, MPs, is to make these decisions, and I don't believe that it's right for MPs to abrogate their responsibility by back-heeling issues like this to the electorate. The timing of the referendum is unfortunate, to say the least. It takes place at a time when Europe is partly in recession, is vulnerable to large influxes of refugees fleeing the war in Syria and Iraq, and other migrants fleeing persecution and repression in countries in North Africa and Asia. At the same time, Russia is flexing its muscles with aggression in Ukraine, has conducted extensive military operations in Syria to help President Assad, aerial operations around the Balkans, the Baltic states, and even forays into UK airspace, and threatens some European states that their energy supplies may be cut off if they respond too unfavourably to Russian aggression. The real response for Britain is not to say, well, all of this is your problem, and shut ourselves off politically and economically from the rest of Europe, but to recognise that it is a geographic and political fact that we are part of a union of nations, yes, a union of nations, not a United States of Europe, a union of nations that share common interests, values and goals, and that our neighbours' problems will soon become our own unless we work with them to help solve them. If we didn't already have a European Union, we would have had to create something similar to deal with these problems and many others as well. Illegal migration, people trafficking, drug smuggling, terrorism, environmental pollution to our rivers and seas, etc. All of the above do not respect national boundaries. By working together in the most successful multinational organisation that the world has ever seen, with its own single market, is a solution to our problems, not a problem in itself. Yes, we have our differences with our European neighbours, but they're settled nowadays on conference tables in places like Brussels, Strasbourg, London, Berlin and Paris, not by bloody wars on European soil, as they were for hundreds of years. And in the case of the last century, those problems escalated into two world wars, resulting in the deaths of millions of people across the globe. The common market, now the EU and NATO, have brought together our peoples in ways we could never have dreamt of as early as 25 years ago. Former Warsaw Pact communist states are now members of the EU and members of NATO. West and East Germany is a united and prosperous country. The accession of these states to the EU has created a market of over 500 million people for British companies to export to, in addition to the 60 million people that we have here in Britain. Opportunities for us to travel, to work, and on holiday in countries once regarded as our enemies. Why would we want to put all of that at risk due to what I regard as petty and good-looking nationalism that would make Britain worse off rather than better off in terms of GDP growth and economic prosperity? Some complain about EU migrants coming to Britain in places like where we are now in Preston. The university here has educated thousands of students from the EU who come here without the hindrance of having to apply for visas And when you realise that each student here brings around £20,000 per annum to the local economy, then that creates many jobs for local people as a knock-on effect. That's just here in Preston. The Polish community and people from other parts of Europe are keeping open many of our schools and churches which would otherwise have closed due to lack of numbers, as well as a generation of the children of previous waves of migration to the UK who have settled here and become part of the rich tapestry that is now Preston in Lancashire. These newer migrants are taking on jobs that some of the indigenous population can't do, either because they're not qualified or simply don't want to do, such as in the health service, public transport, and many other walks of life throughout the city. Only a small minority of those are claiming benefits, not most, as some would have you believe. But they came here to work. And this is not one-way traffic. As I said earlier, there are up to 1 million people, British people, have found new opportunities living in other parts of the EU, most of whom work, raise their families, and contribute to taxes over in those countries, and also send lots of money back to this country. Do we really want them to be forced to come home because we've left the European Union? These are the dangers. There are dangers with open borders and the free movement of people. But Britain is not signed up to the EU's Schengen Agreement, which allows people to travel across European boundaries without border checks. We have passport controls and customs controls at all of our ports while we are in the EU, unlike many other European neighbours. So we can check who is coming into the country legally or illegally through these measures. Leaving the EU will not stop illegal migration. Norway and Switzerland are not in the EU, but face the same illegal migration problems. Terrorists that are in many countries in Europe commit acts in their own country and are not imported in many cases, but indigenous, like the 7/7 bombers that put the bombs on the train in London. The fact that we are not in Schengen means that the bombers that travelled from Brussels to Paris would have been checked at our border if they had tried to come into the EU. This wasn't the case when they travelled to and returned from Paris. I've spoken about how we can deal with the problems we face in Europe together and how mutual cooperation can benefit all of the countries that are members. History, solidarity, and common sense, I believe, are good reasons for staying in the EU. But I recognise that I am in a seat of learning tonight, so I must be a little bit more analytical and objective. So let me be a little bit more hard-headed about this and talk in terms of the costs and the benefits. I've said little about the benefits and many of the things that we take for granted. The anti-Europeans and the xenophobes who say Europe is a threat totally disregard the decades of successful membership which has contributed into making Britain into the world's fifth largest economy. We're the fifth largest economy in the world, partly because we're in the EU, not in spite of it. Yes, we could survive outside the European Union. Yes, we could manage outside the European Union. But at what price? And believe me, there would be a price. The benefits of being a member of the largest single market in the world has costs, and that's why we pay contributions for membership, as you would if you joined any club. You do so because you accept the benefits outweigh the costs. Let's see, for example, what the UK's largest business organisation, the CBI, says. Access to a $16.6 trillion a year single market of 500 million people is the key benefit. UK firms' access to the single market goes beyond standard free trade agreements. We've heard a great deal of discussion about free trade agreements, but free trade agreements are only on goods and services that countries agree between themselves, not the wide panoply of everything that makes up an economy. The EU has eliminated tariff barriers and customs procedures within its borders and has taken strides towards removing non-tariff barriers such as various product regulations. 76% of CBI members say that the ability to buy freely and sell products in the EU has a positive impact on their business, and that includes 74% of small and medium-sized businesses. It has been estimated that UK trade with some countries in Europe could have increased by as much as 50% as a result of EU membership. The single market also underpins access to European supply chains. In 2009, $207 billion of the UK's total $293 billion of exports went to the rest of the EU27 and was used as inputs to industries rather than being consumed directly. And the UK imported $161 billion of intermediates from the EU, which are important to things such as our National Health Service. Free movement of labour helps UK businesses plug skills gaps. 63% of CBI members say that the ability to recruit and transfer staff from the EU has been positive for business. And we've heard from Mike tonight how positive it is as well to be able to recruit staff from across Europe. And that includes 48% of small and medium-sized enterprises who said the same. Overall, only 1% of the members of the CBI said the impact had been negative, and only 2% of SMEs said it had been negative. UK citizens have also benefited from the free movement of labour. As I said earlier, at least 750,000 people are working in other EU countries, and 1 million live in other EU countries. This is a recognition that there is a recognition that common rules are needed, standards, regulations, health and safety. What people call bureaucracy, people in workplace call health and safety. This so-called red tape that we talk about with directives, food standards that make sure that the food is edible. It's standards that make sure that the air that we breathe is clean. It's standards that say that the rivers and the seas around us are clean. These are the sorts of things that people describe as red tape. The UK's net budgetary contribution is a small net cost, and it's the earlier speaker didn't mention is the fact that the net cost is relatively small. The net contribution is only 7.3, not the 11 point something billion that I think was mentioned earlier, and is only 0.4% of GDP. As a comparison, that's around a quarter of what the UK spends on the Department for Business, Innovation and Skills, and less than an eighth of the UK's defence spend. The £116 per person net contribution is less than that from Sweden, Denmark, Finland, Germany and the Netherlands. So the largest organisation representing business is very much in favour of us remaining in the EU. What does the largest organisation representing workers say? They say that many rights accumulated over decades, including paid annual leave, time off for antenatal appointments, fair treatment for part-time workers, are used every day by millions of workers in this country and are now taken for granted. But if the UK votes to leave the EU, no one can say what will happen to these rights. Francis O'Grady, the General Secretary of the TUC, said that the benefits of EU membership for workers are wide-ranging in scope, including access, as I say, to paid annual holidays, improved health and safety protection, rights to unpaid parental leave, rights off to time off work for urgent family reason, equal treatment rights for part-time, fixed terms and agency workers, right for outsourced workers, and rights for workers' representatives to receive information and to be consulted on changes at work, particularly in the context of restructuring of businesses. The TUC General Secretary went on to say, working people have a huge stake in the referendum because workers' rights are on the line. It's the EU that guarantees workers their rights. These rights can't be taken for granted. There are no guarantees that any government will keep them if the UK leaves the EU. And without the backup of those EU laws, unscrupulous employers will have free rein to cut many of the workers' hard-won benefits and protections. This county has, in BAE Systems, a major industry that in the last century built military aircraft to fight Germany. Today, it builds aircraft with German, Italian and Spanish companies to protect Europe. BAE is also working with the Americans to develop the new F-35 fighter. This is about industrial cooperation as much as military cooperation. The developing trade deal between the US and the European Union will bring us even closer together into an even bigger market to grow mutual prosperity. Leaving the EU means not only a risk to our business in Europe, but also risk to a good trade deal with the United States. EU membership, I believe, should be treasured and valued. Let's not let the narrow-minded nationalists bring us out. Remember, for your sake and the country's sake, remain. Thank you.
Mark Hendrick there with the depressing view for some that this could be a never-ender. Mark made several, lots of points. The world's too unstable to be leaving Europe. We are a union of nations, lots of problems to tackle. We should tackle them together. EU has kept peace in Europe. It's helped the rights of working people. Also made the point that we are the fifth largest economy because of the EU and not despite it. So, now, I have some very welcome news to tell you. I'm very happy news, actually, that I am actually not the oldest person on this panel. There is somebody else who did vote in the 1970s on Europe, and he voted yes. And now this man is voting no. This is John Bickley. He's a Manchester businessman. He's a parliamentary candidate and party treasurer for the UK Independence Party, UKIP. He's a man who came close to overturning an 11,000 Labour majority in the Haywood and Middleton by-election. By just 600 votes, he lost it. In 2015, he stood for UKIP in Oldham West, and he came second to Labour. Of course, UKIP was formed in 1993 to campaign for withdrawal from the EU. Could you please, John, take the microphone and give us your take on the referendum? Thank you.
Good evening. Can you hear me okay? Yes. Well, you know what would be really interesting? If the vote on the 23rd of June was a vote to join the EU, I wonder what the result would be. I'd put my house on it. It'd be a substantial no. I think between 65 and 75% of people would say, no, we don't want to join the EU. So that's an interesting dilemma, isn't it? Given I think it's even accepted by the Remain side, that if this was a vote to join the EU, they'd lose big time. So why are people so scared to leave? Because I reckon there's about 15 to 20% of people who would not vote to join, who possibly will vote to stay or abstain. And understandably, that's probably because they're worried about what it means to come out. And it pretty much explains why the Remain camp have pretty much launched Project Fear, much as they did in Scotland. They just want to scare you to death that somehow this little country called Great Britain, the fifth largest economy in the world, is incapable of actually running its own affairs and trading with the world as a fully sovereign nation. I think they've given up on Britain, once the world's greatest trading nation. To be honest with you, if my father was alive today, I think he just wouldn't understand why he and millions of people in World War II sacrificed their lives so that this country could remain a free and sovereign nation. In fact, I'm glad he's not here today to witness what many of us believe is nothing short of betrayal of the sacrifices he and his generation made, because our political class have effectively been giving away our sovereignty for the last 40 years. Now, in 1975, I was 22 and I voted to stay in the EEC. I, like many other people, were told we were members of an economic union. And most voters back then thought, great, that's an easy way to trade with each other. But we were lied to, and we're still being lied to, because the EU's grand plan has always to become a superstate. I mean, it's there in the Treaty of Rome. You listen to the EU commissioners, you listen to key people in France and Germany and elsewhere. They have a goal to become an EU superstate, which will mean nation states will be relegated to regions. And it's quite likely that in the long term, national parliaments will be neutered and maybe even abolished. And voters will have no ability to throw out the lawmakers and repeal bad laws. That's what we can do now to some degree. you get rid of the people you don't like in Parliament and you get rid of the laws they make, although we now can't get rid of the laws made by the EU. And I want to hear the Remain camp be honest with you and tell you that the EU's endgame is the creation of a superstate, one that you will not, if they can help it, have any say in stopping. The plan has always been to impose this on the citizens of Europe, whether they want it or not. That's not democracy. That's a form of totalitarianism. The establishment, the multinationals, financial institutions like Goldman Sachs, the Tory, Labour and Liberal parties all want to lock the UK into an undemocratic, corrupt and failing political project called the EU. They all have a vested interest. Vast wealth, power and lucrative sinecures are bywords for the key architects and supporters of the EU. Thousands of lobbyists live in Brussels. They're not there to look after your interests. They're there to look after the interests of big business. They're the people that the EU Commission listens to. They listen to big business and their lobbyists. They don't listen to you. Failed politicians like Mandelson and Kinnock, they've made millions of pounds out of playing the EU game and supporting it. And by the way, their pensions continue to be paid only if they keep towing the party line. Their pensions can be lowered or stopped if they decide to be anti-EU. And I find the behaviour of the Tory, Labour and Liberal parties quite interesting. They strut around Westminster, giving the impression they're in control, when in so many ways they're not. We don't control our borders anymore with the EU. Our Supreme Court, that's a funny word, it's an oxymoron, and law is effectively subject to EU law. Our fishing grounds are controlled by the EU. In almost all government departments and agencies and NGOs, the EU's influence is all-pervading. However, none of us have been asked if this is how we want to be governed. Now let's look at the Tory party. They took us into the EU project on a lie. They knew what this was all about, and for 40 years they've tried to pretend they were Eurosceptic, when it's now plain to see that they're the opposite. They don't believe in Britain. They bought into the EU superstate sales pitch. And they've allowed some of their Eurosceptic MPs to join Vote Leave, to sort of give the impression that the Tory party is allowing dissent and that they support Vote Leave to some degree. They can't have it both ways. Actually, I think I know why they're doing it. They looked at what happened to the Labour Party in Scotland, who basically backed the Stay campaign, and almost half the Scottish voters looked at the Labour Party and think, you didn't support me, and guess what happened? They wiped the Labour Party out at the next general election. And I think the Tory party in particular are quite worried about that. They're trying to face both ways. And what about the Labour Party? Supposedly the party of the working class, but happy to see millions of EU citizens come to the UK and take the jobs of British workers and depressed wages. Now, I want to make it clear, if I lived in Eastern Europe on €100 a month, I'd be the first one on the bus. Why wouldn't I be? However, isn't it the first duty of government to look after their own citizens? Not a foreign entity like the EU and work for faceless multinationals who love cheap labour. And a large percentage of the Labour Party, including Jeremy Corbyn, don't like the EU. Go back to the time of Tony Benn. He got it right. He said the EU was anti-democratic and corporatist. Bang on. Absolutely bang on. Even some unions like the RMT, they want out of the EU. So why is the Labour Party ignoring the wishes of its own members and voters? Is it because only the EU can force Labour Party policy on the UK without a mandate from the people? Labour know that if they wouldn't get elected if they pushed some of the EU policy agenda in a manifesto over in this country. So they hide behind the EU. It suits them. Now, without UKIP, there wouldn't be a referendum. That's a fact. We forced Cameron and the Tory party into having one. And without UKIP, there wouldn't be a single mainstream political party in this country supporting Vote Leave. In a democracy, I think that's quite frightening, particularly when you consider what's at stake. If you believe in a sovereign nation, then you have to accept that control of lawmaking, your currency and borders are cornerstones of being a sovereign nation. You can't be half pregnant. You're either a sovereign nation or you're not. Now, what about trade? There's been some talk about that tonight. And we keep hearing all sorts of doom and gloom stories from the Remain side about our economy and our ability to trade internationally with the EU, if we leave the EU, being a disaster. Whether we like it or not, we live in a globalised economy. Most countries do business with each other without a trade deal. In 2014, China sold 1.5 times as much as us to the EU. But China's not a member of the EU and doesn't have a trade deal with the EU. So how's that work? It's called trading. In 2013, trade with the EU of the top 20 countries not in the EU was 2.6 billion. That's more than the size of the French economy and the UK economy. 6 of the top 10 exporters to the EU in 2013 don't have a free trade deal with Europe. So this idea you've got to have a free trade deal or be a member of the EU is a fallacy. The EU trades and EU countries trade with the whole world. Yes, a free trade agreement would be preferable. However, it won't stop the UK trading with the EU if we leave. The global economy is underpinned by business to business and business to consumers, and that's not going to stop by government diktat. Now, what about the EU? In 1980, it was responsible for 31% of global output. Pretty impressive, nice place to be. In 2014, it had dropped to 18%. And it's predicted in 2039, the EU will be less than 10% of global output. Now, why would the UK want to tie itself to a political superstate whose share of global trade is diminishing by the year? Now, what about our own country? Think of it as a company. Around 10% of our turnover is exports to the EU. That's it. 90% of our turnover has got nothing to do with the EU. So if you were a company, why would you allow a customer responsible for 10% of your turnover to tell you how to run the rest of your business, to tell you how you had to deal with the other 90% of your business that's got nothing to do with them? And as has already been mentioned, the EU sells significantly more to us than vice versa. They need access to the UK market. And I always apply what I call the BMW and Mercedes-Benz test. Tonight, when you're going home, stop on the corner of one of the main roads and watch how many German cars go past. There's millions of jobs in Germany and Austria and the rest of the EU that rely on being able to sell those Mercedes-Benz and BMWs and Audis and what have you to this country. Do you think the chairman of those companies are going to allow Angela Merkel to cause us a problem? They'll tell her quite clearly, if you cause any problems if the UK leaves, you're going to have to go on TV tonight and explain to hundreds of thousands of German workers why we're going to have to lay them off. Ain't going to happen. It's vital that we continue to trade with the EU, and we have to be sensible about that and constructive, and we will be. Now, again, look at the EU, and we're being told that, you know, we play an important part of the EU and we influence things. Well, in 1979, we had 20% of the MEPs in the European Parliament. Is now less than 10%. In 1975, our votes on the Council of Ministers were 17%. It's now 8%, and yet we're the second largest contributor funder of the EU. In 1979, we had 2 of the 13 commissioners. We now have 1 of 28. The truth is, our influence in the EU has been on the wane for years. Most decisions in the EU were taken to suit the Eurozone, which we're not in, thank goodness. Joining the EEC in 1973 probably made a lot of sense. Those of you who are as old as me remember we were the sick man of Europe. But really, if the EU was more like NAFTA, the North American Free Trade Association, that'd be interesting. Mexico exports 84% of its goods to NAFTA countries, Canada 78%. But in NAFTA, there's no freedom of movement, and the countries in NAFTA, Mexico, Canada, and the USA remain sovereign. They make their own laws, but they trade together. I'd be quite happy to stay a member of a NAFTA-esque trade bloc, but that's not what the EU wants to be. So here's what I think. The UK is the world's fifth largest economy. Just think about that, the world's fifth largest economy. We're a pretty big fish in a pretty big pond. The city, warts and all, is the largest financial centre in the world. English is the universal language, universal business language. We sit at the centre of Greenwich Mean Time, which means we're able to talk to the world, east and west, 24 hours a day. The Commonwealth, the UK's historical natural ally, is growing at a much faster rate than the EU. We need to re-engage with the Commonwealth, not least because we'll be able to buy food from them a lot cheaper than we're currently paying for it now, being with inside the EU. But more than that, we need to regain our confidence as a country. It was at rock bottom in 1973 when we felt we had to join the EEC. We need to retake our position, our vacated seat on the World Trade Organization. We need to be outward looking and do what we used to do, which was be a globally dominant trading nation. We can do that again. I want us to be an independent sovereign nation. I don't want us to be a star on someone else's flag. Thank you.
John, thank you very much indeed. John's saying if folk were asked to join the EU now, they'd say no, we can't get rid of the laws that are made in Europe, we don't control our borders, our fishing. Europe aims to create a super state. It's the establishment that has a vested interest in Europe. It's anti-democratic, and we're either a sovereign nation or we are not. And finally, most businesses do business without a trade deal. Well, we're going to take a vote from you just very shortly, but what I'd like to do before we finish is just to sum up. You've listened to the arguments that Leave have put, and you've listened to the arguments that Remain have put. So can we start with you, Mike Thomas, Professor Thomas? If we left the EU, the suggestion is we should be looking beyond European shores. And in fact, UCLan's already doing that with its education, isn't it?
It is. But if I don't want to be negative. You know, there are lots of really good reasons why we should remain in Europe. But here's something about global trading and global exchanges. Nothing to do with Europe. The UK government has decided over the last few years, because of its migration numbers issues, to reduce the number of international students coming into the UK. In one university, there's been a 40% reduction in Indian students coming to study in the UK. They're now choosing to go to America or China, but not coming to the UK. And I'm not trying to say, oh, it's all anxiety and fear, but that's nothing to do with Europe. But if we did come out of Europe, there is nothing to stop the European migration numbers going into the UK migration figures, and we would lose that £3.2 billion that European students spend in the UK. And I think that would harm the economy.
Anything else, Mike, you want to come back with before you finish?
I'll sum up very quickly. It's all speculation. We don't know if we come out of Europe. People go, we put a lot in, but we get a lot out. We don't know if any government in the future will go, well, we'll duplicate that in the UK. We'll give you the same amount of Erasmus, so 200,000 students can study in Europe. We'll give you the same European Regional Development Fund, which helps the Northwest in particular. Or we'll give you the 20% of research funding and others, such as the NHS, or the CAP numbers that Mark talked about. We don't know if farmers will get the same subsidy after the election. And I think that it's just as speculative to say that about the UK and European movements. I also think everybody speculates about the future, but we can make it up. We know for a fact that Esso, for instance, and Shell, every year paid millions and millions of dollars to experts who could predict the next year's oil barrel. They've never had it right since 1955. So, and we can be full of fear. We really could be full of fear and anxiety. But we could also be full of hope and optimism. You know, I like the UK. I like the UK people. We're really bad moodish and irritable a lot of the time.
Do you like the EU?
I do.
You do, fine.
But just say this last part. We are tenacious and we are brave and we are courageous. And we don't walk away from things because we don't like it. We stay like we did throughout our 20th century. We stay and fight. That's better than walking away. And I think on the 23rd of June, make sure your heart and your head go together.
Mark Hendrick, briefly, are you running Project Fear?
Well, I think there's a lot to be frightened about. And what was interesting was in Mr. Bickley's response, he talked about Project Fear and then gave 101 reasons why we should be frightened of staying in. So, you know, I think there's a bit of it coming from both sides. I am frightened. I'm frightened that everything that we've managed to achieve by being an integral part of Europe is now being placed at risk. People talk as if we still had an empire. I know those countries are referred to now as the Commonwealth, but we can still trade with those countries. We do trade with those countries, but very often it's in raw materials or things like fruit, not very sophisticated products. That sort of trade will continue, and I want to increase trade with other members, sorry, with other countries outside of the EU. But I think within the EU, as I said, the fact that we've got a single market, not a trade deal, but a single market where anybody can buy and sell anything, whether you know it's financial services or widgets, is a huge advantage. It's like, you know, extending the borders of our own economy and embracing the whole of the European economy. So you've got that many more customers and that many more people you can deal with. A free trade deal, whether it's through EFTA, and by the way, we don't know if we would be allowed in EFTA. EFTA was supposed to be for countries going into the European Union, not countries coming in the other direction. So we may not be allowed into EFTA. And in fact, all of Dr. Bainbridge's arguments were peppered with words like, well, maybe, well, perhaps, or it's likely that. The big problem with the out campaign is that nobody knows what out looks like. And that is why I'm frightened. I'm not frightened of staying in. I know what I'm dealing with. No more than most. I spent 5 years in Brussels and Strasbourg passing laws as a democratically elected MEP. And we've got heads of government in the Council of Ministers who were democratically elected. This idea that it's not democratic is just bunkum. You know, and we have got less MEPs, but we've got less MEPs because the European Union is not 12 countries like it was when I was in the European Parliament. It's now 28 countries, and I'm happy that we've only got, we've got less MEPs because otherwise the European Parliament will be 2,000 members, not 800 that it is at the moment. Now, the Westminster Parliament is over 600. Could you imagine trying to operate a parliament with, you know, over 1,000 members? It's just not practical. So yes, we have less influence, but we still have a great deal of influence over the largest trading bloc in the whole of the world. It's the envy of many others in the world. Losing it or moving out of it is cutting off our nose to spite our face. Stay.
Dr. Mark Baimbridge, are a lot of maybes in what you were saying, possibles, and we're the fifth largest economy in the world because of the EU.
I would suggest that if we were outside the EU, we could have been a larger economy. I mean, that's the point. I mean, the Project Fear thing for me is pointing out worst-case scenarios. So a lot of what our opponents were talking about were, again, these issues in terms of we wouldn't be able to do this, we wouldn't be able to do that. What they say, miss the point, is the size of the UK economy, how we trade with the rest of the world, how we trade with the EU. It is very much two sides of the coin. Europe needs to sell things to us. We are interested in selling things to the rest of the world. That's where the competitiveness lies. They are not going to step away from trading with us because, as John was saying, they need to fulfill those order books. On a couple of points, I would agree with what Mike was saying in terms of the student thing. I think that the immigration numbers is just an anomaly in terms of how things are counted. I think that's a very bad idea. The government itself is split on this. The BIS kind of say, no, you shouldn't be counting them, and the Home Office says you should be counting them. So that's a sort of internal issue. In terms of forecasting, I agree perfectly on the idea of forecasting. The key thing if you're going to be an economic forecaster is to forecast frequently. And that way you've got a chance of getting it right, which worries me about the Treasury's forecasts in terms of where we're going to be in 2030. So I would put that back to you in terms of the forecasting issue again. So forecast a lot of times. In terms of the issues, in terms of the positive nature of it, which again Mike was sort of talking about, my view on that is I would take that forward in a different way. The positive nature I would see is saying, yes, there is a positive angle to this. The positive angle to this is Britain becoming an independent, strong economy in the global economy. We have the technology, as it were. We have things like a world-class education system, which I'm sure Mike would agree with on that as well. I'm tying him into corners here, being naughty of me.
But
we have that. We are not a helpless economy. We have high-tech industries, as we've been talking about with BAE Systems. We have high-skilled workforce, and that can take us forwards. So my view is, in terms of a positive view on this, is to turn this around, is to think about not the worst case scenarios in terms of what could happen, but to think about the positive alternatives that we could have as an economy and how that could make us stronger. So my argument is, in terms of the referendum, is to leave.
Well, John Bickley, a couple of quotes come to mind. One was, the idea that the EC is not democratic is bunkum. And also, I think, narrow-minded nationalists was also said at one stage. What is your summing up, do you think?
Well, I mean, I think those are red herrings. I mean, I'm an internationalist in that, you know, in my working days, I worked for two American multinationals and the Sony Corporation, and I opened offices all over the world and spent most of my time opening offices in Europe and working in Europe. I think Europe's an unbelievably fantastic place. I love the diversity. And what struck me when I worked in Europe during the 90s and the noughties was the number of people over there who just didn't like what the EU was becoming. They didn't like the red tape. So I have this outward-looking positivity about our country. I'm sorry, the EU is in decline when you look at it from a trade point of view. It was important in the 80s, it was almost a third of world output. It's now under 20%, and it's going to be, at best, 10% in a couple of decades. So if you're looking at our country as a means of generating jobs and wealth, and you look at your target markets, you'd be thinking, you know what? The growth is in the rest of the world. It's not in the EU. Yes, we want to keep trading with them. We'll keep buying BMWs. And they'll keep buying Land Rovers and all these other things. But the rest of the world is where all the growth is coming from. That's what you would do as a business to ensure you had a great future. And let's remember, the experts that keep telling us, well, you know, it's a bit worrying all of this if we leave. Many of these are the same people that told us not that long ago, oh, if you don't join the euro, that's it, it's all over. UK's finished. They're all a bit quiet now. Actually, some of them aren't. They've decided they don't want to remind us that they were wrong then. The Treasury told us in 2010, along with George Osborne, he was going to eliminate the deficit in one parliament. That never happened. And now, apparently, they're going to eliminate it in the second parliament. And I think most of us don't expect the deficit to be eliminated. So here we have the so-called experts who get it wrong on so many occasions. They got the crash wrong in 1998, the banks and the government. So I don't really pay much attention to these experts. I look at business and I look at trends. We're in a global economy. Yes, we want to trade with the world. We don't need to be in a political union. We need to be a confident, sovereign nation, proud of who we are, proud of our values, and trading with the rest of the world. Thank you.
This is where you come and play again. I don't know, you've got your cards in front of you. There's the red one and there's the blue one. Has anybody, before we put the cards up, has anybody, brave enough to put the hand up, has anybody been swayed by what they've heard tonight? Are you all, oh, yeah, that's one or two, right, okay. So it has actually changed your opinion, or it might change your opinion.
Not me.
Right, shall we have those cards up again then?
More question than that, Sam.
I actually think there are more leave cards going up. I have to be honest, don't you?
No.
Well, I actually think there are more leave cards going up, I have to say. What do you think? Our economists, the man with the figures.
I can't count that quickly.
But. Yeah, but definitely Remain is still ahead, but there's still a few more reds going up. Listen. It's a very emotive subject, this, and we did have heavies on the door to deal with any troublemakers. We haven't had to use them. You've been a great audience. Thank you very much. Can we thank our panel?
Mike Thomas, Mark Hendrick, Dr Mark Baimbridge, and John Bickley. Thank you very much.